Hello everyone, welcome to this webinar on how to introduce IT into your record keeping practices. This is the fourth and final in a series of webinars which have initially looked at the ethics and legalities of record keeping, as well as the kind of quality of record keeping needed to produce best quality professional practice. Firstly, may I introduce you to the acknowledgement of country. Now, that acknowledgement was signed off by Graham Davidson, who's the head of the APS Institute, which is bringing you this series of webinars amongst many others. For the last year and a half at least, Graham and I have worked together to travel the country to produce all-day workshops on how to bring IT into your practice, with a small section on advanced record keeping. And this 1 hour together, and a little bit more, is a distillation of those live workshops into hopefully a very workable, useful, and may I dare say, fun way to have IT become part of your way of doing your practice. In many cases, record keeping is what we call in the IT trade a hafta. It's something you've got to do in order to be considered professional and to protect yourself and to promote your practice and do the best by your clients. But in many cases, what we want to do in IT when we bring it into practice is make it become not a hafta, but a wanna. Now, that is, you want to use these technologies because they make your practice more effective, more efficient, they protect you, they lower your risk, and dare I say it once more, they're fun to use. Now, this workshop will stand on the shoulders of the work of Alfred and Tony that came before me in these last couple of weeks. In a sense, they use what we could quote to be a Rudyard Kipling poem. Let me read that poem to you. I keep six honest serving men. They taught me all I knew. Their names are what and why and when, and how and where and who. That's Rudyard Kipling's poem. And in many cases, all of those things are what goes into good record keeping. Tonight, we're going to focus on the how. How do we do these things using the technologies which are available, and indeed which will soon become available? So there's a little bit of fortune telling that's going to go on too within our seminar tonight. Now, in this last year, in formulating what would an all-day workshop look like, I constructed this mind map. Some of you will be experienced at creating maps. Those of you who are into family therapy and such will, of course, have been using genograms for all of your training and your practice for showing the relationships between various family members as well as outside stakeholders. Mind mapping is becoming quite a popular thing in corporate work. And here is the mind map that I created when I wanted to outline for myself what are the sort of issues that we need to come to terms with when it comes to deciding how to incorporate IT into our record keeping. If we go over to the left of the mind map, you will see the area that I want to cover tonight. These are, in fact, the technologies that we're going to be looking at. However, I do want to make it fairly clear that the old dictum of don't give a starving man a fish, but teach him and his family or her family how to fish is really kind of where I want to go. So we're going to spend a little bit of time early on, just the first 15 minutes or so, looking at a philosophy of technology and psychological practice, rather than merely looking at some of the tools, because I want you to come away with the idea that one can incorporate technology cautiously, carefully, and ultimately successfully in such an important area as record keeping and note taking. In particular, the easiest way to integrate technologies into your practice is perhaps thinking of going paperless. The truth of the matter is that in the next little while it's more about using less paper than going completely paperless. I don't know that that's going to happen in the next little while, but it's something to aim for. But if we keep in mind the idea of going less paper, then there's a chance for us to incorporate some new technologies and go from a hafta into a wanna state of mind. One of the things I need to point out to you as I travel around the country is something that I've learnt. And I've been talking about technology to psychologists and writing about it in InPsych. Some of you may have read some of my articles. Is that we psychologists are not necessarily rushers to get new technologies. We're actually very late adopters if we compare ourselves to other professions. And there's several reasons for that. Let me draw a contrast, if you like, between how psychologists train and then work with those in our colleagues in allied health. Dentists, physiotherapists, optometrists seem to run on dual tracks during their training. They learn, of course, the theory of their profession, the anatomy, the physiology, the morphology, the pharmaceutical aspects. But the dual track part is that almost at the same time, they're learning to use tools. They understand that tools and technologies are part of the way they work. It may well be that from year one to year six, when they graduate, new tools may have emerged. And in fact, during the course of their lifetime of professional practice, those tools will change. New methods of assessment, diagnosis, intervention. But nonetheless, they become comfortable, I believe, in using their tools. Think about the tools that you used when you were an undergraduate and then a postgraduate in order to get registration. And which of those tools you're currently using in private practice or in an agency or in a GP practice or in a corporate situation. I guess you'll find that there's been very little carryover, unlike our friends in allied health. And that's one of the situations that we confront. We've not really been trained well to think about technologies in practice. All we need is a set of these, a pen and a paper, and maybe a phone, not even a smartphone, but a dumb phone. Something that makes calls, receives SMSs and sends them, maybe has a calendar built in, and we're on our way. In fact, even to go into a practice in allied health is going to cost you a large amount of money just to set up. Whereas in a practice in psychology, you can discover you find a room to rent for $15 once you're registered, pen, paper, filing cabinet even, maybe just a briefcase, and you're away. It's a very different approach to setting up in private practice than it is for allied health. Now, I want to share with you the four qualities of great technologies which I believe one needs to consider when incorporating new technologies into practice. Because of the way our brains have evolved, we've become the Earth's premier tool builders. We are terrific at building tools out of the common clay, as the saying goes. These four qualities of great tools, of great technologies, are these. One, they're enablers. They enable us to do things that our human form prevents us from doing. Flying is one of them. I work with people who have fear of flying, and they often say to me, well, if God had meant us to fly, well, he would have given us wings, as if that's all you need to fly. To which my response is, well, if we were not meant to fly, God would not have given us a brain that allows us to design such things to allow us to fly. We then move on to other things. Nonetheless, enabling is what technologies allow us to do. Overcome our human limitations to do things that ordinarily we can't do. Two, they take what we can do, but allow us to do those things in situations which ordinarily our human frailty doesn't allow us to do. We call that extending. So after enabling, we have extend. To enable us to do things in ways that we ordinarily can't do, so that we can lift heavier things. We can stay underwater for longer than ordinarily we could without artificial respiration, scuba diving equipment, for instance. We can see things with microscopes that our visual system usually doesn't let us see. And we can hear things that usually our limited auditory range doesn't let us hear. So that's enable and extend. The third one, and a lot of our new technologies allow us to do this, is augment. That is, it adds another layer of information beyond what our senses can perceive. So if I hold my iPhone up to the sky to take a picture, but I have a particular app available to me. I can see what's out there that my eye can't normally see. And that's because the technology I'm using, my smartphone, has an app that allows me to see all the aircraft that are in my vicinity, not just see them on the screen in their proximity to me, but also know something about those aircraft. What's their altitude, their heading, their speed, its registration number, which airline is it for, when it's due to land in its city of destination. So this is augmenting. You can just imagine, perhaps, holding up a series of binoculars at a concert that you go to, and you can pan across the orchestra and just see who those individual orchestra members are, because perhaps they're wearing name tags, which are not just names, but they actually have radio frequencies built into them, and we can actually see who these people are in our binoculars. And if you think about it, Google Glass, which many have touted as a great breakthrough, especially for training, especially for doctors who are using it, that's a form of augmented reality where we can see things which our eyes ordinarily can't see. There are, of course, some social issues involved with all of us walking around with Google Glass. I'm not too sure it's going to be the great success that some believe it will be. So we have three so far: enabling, extending, augmenting. And the fourth one, which is turning out to be one of the most popular ones, and that it's a connecting device. It connects us up with other people. It connects us up with other organizations and industries and all sorts of things. And when I think about connecting, I also think about sharing. So it's a two-way street. We can share things with other people. So they're my four main things that I look for in a technology. Can it help me do these four things better than my existing technologies can? Enabling, extending, augmenting, and sharing. Now, I want to take you on a further little journey into technologies and look at how technologies can be integrated into practice once one overcomes one's concern that one is incompetent or unable to use technologies. I borrow the next little piece from a Twitter feed, would you believe, which I observed as part of an educational conference occurring in the United States. I actually do a lot of my continuing education with regard to how to employ technologies using Twitter to see what's going on internationally as well as locally. And this particular tweet came to me in November last year, and it shows a picture of a stage of competence. And it was called Teacher Confidence in the Use of Technology, based upon the work of Mandenach and Klein, who were some educational researchers in 1994, thereabouts. So let me have a close-up look at what the tweet actually had to say. So you can include in a tweet a comment plus a picture. And here's what the tweet says. A poster showing teacher confidence in technology administrators. It's crucial staff get proper PD. And the last I ran a workshop looking at integrating iPads, a counsellor, a psychologist counsellor at a major teaching university had been given, her whole department in fact had been given iPads, but not told how to use them. The expectation was, well, you're a young group of wither people, you know how to operate one. But operating one is not the same as integrating it into a counselling practice. And that's one of the reasons why I should come to the workshop. That particular quote, by the way, that confidence, competence, changing levels, comes from this particular website, a guy called Mark Anderson, who was the actual presenter at this workshop in the United States. And he runs this page called ICT Evangelist, where he tries to encourage, as I do, his colleagues in teaching to look more closely at what information and communication technologies can offer. And so he produced that particular graph. Let's take a closer look, because he's basing his work on the theory put forward in this book in 1994, Classroom Dynamics, Implementing a Technology-Based Learning Environment. And we could say therapeutic dynamics or psychological dynamics, implementing a technology-based psychological environment. or behavior change environment for that matter. In any case, let's take a closer look at what he had to say. And I've kind of repurposed that diagram. And for a moment, we'll just stick with teacher confidence and then we'll change it over to psychologist confidence in the use of technology. Let me take you through these four stages or four. And so originally in the graph or in the article, we're hearing terms used mainly in the teaching profession. So we start at the lower left-hand side in survival under the level. And here is what's called expansion, what we would in fact call self-talk. I'm scared of breaking it. I'm not sure what to do. I think I should use this in lessons, but I'm not sure how. And I want you, as we go through these stages, think about some of the technologies that you've been employing recently or been thinking about employing recently, and whether the kind of expansion or what we would call self-talk applies to you. Next level up, huge jump. Teacher confidence improves dramatically, and we leap to mastery. Here's the expansion of the self-talk here. I've received training, I've practiced with apps, I've trialed it in lessons with success, and I'm feeling more confident. So we've got two more levels to go. So what happens after mastery? Well, let's have a look. Something called impact, where you can start to measure how your practice is changing in the teaching group, how your teaching is becoming more effective. And here's the expansion of the self-talk. Students and I are using tech effectively. It's embedded in my lessons and planning where appropriate. So where appropriate is the important part here, because it says, I'm not just going to employ technology because it exists, nor am I going to have the belief that because it's technology, it's better than what's come before. And I think that would be reasonable to say. The idea that technology is better because it's technology, we call technological determinism, and one ought not to be rushed into using technology or feel the pressure to use it simply because it exists. It has to have a reason for being employed rather than just being a new technology. Let's now come to the fourth level, which is called innovation. And here's the self-talk for innovation. Technology use is pervasive. I'm digitally literate, as I am with pedagogy, and I innovate and share, which is quite interesting because it goes to that fourth aspect of technology I talked about before, about sharing and connectivity. Let's shift this around and have a look at what it might look like if we decided not to call it teacher confidence, but to call it psychological confidence or psychologist confidence. So let's cross out teacher. Let's cross out all the things that really aren't relevant to psychologists and replace them with other words. So we'll cross out expansion, that becomes self-talk. We'll cross out where it says lessons, and that of course should be replaced with sessions. Yeah. Where else? Mastery changes over and becomes, I think, coping. And I think most of us, when we work with patients, don't jump from first presentations into mastery. We aim for coping, and many of our patients are quite happy just to cope and later on think about mastery. Next level, rather than I'm happy with that. I'll leave innovation where it is because I think that's quite cool. Students, of course, becomes clients or patients or colleagues, wherever it might be. And in the final one, in the green there, we'll get rid of that part and we will replace it with professional practice. So let's have a look at what this now looks like. Psychologist confidence in the use of technology. I'm scared of breaking it. I'm not sure what to do. I think I should use it. Or how? Then we come to coping. I've received training. I've practiced with it or with apps. I've trialed it in sessions with success and I'm feeling more confident. That's a nice bit of self-talk, don't you think? I've combined mastery and impact, and I think mastery is something along the lines of being able to measure the impact. How is my practice changing it? And that's both in qualitative terms and in quantitative terms. So here we are. Clients and I are using tech effectively, and the implicit is that we're encouraging our clients to use the available technologies they have. Sometimes it's what they walk in with in their pockets, and other times we might introduce them to an inexpensive technology that they can use for themselves, which might be an app on a smartphone or a tablet. Tech is embedded in my sessions and planning where appropriate, and my confidence grows. So again, it's a measure that I'm actually feeling more confident with this. I'm actually able to explore new technologies based on the ones that I've become more adept at using. The fourth level, or the fourth stage, is innovation. Technology use is pervasive. I am as digital literate as I am with professional practice. I innovate and share. And in this case, I want to suggest to you that innovate means making new uses of technologies beyond what the original inventor may have had in mind. And this is because technology often leads a double life. The original intention, the problem that was being solved for this technology, and then someone else comes along later on and co-opts that technology and develops new uses for it beyond which the original inventor thought it was going to go. So with the invention of the iPad, for instance, there was great expectation that it would be used merely as a consumption device. That is, people would read on it or surf or do email. But no one really thought at the time it was invented in 2010 or came to market in 2010 that people would use it so creatively to create books and so forth. And so that's the innovation and share part of it. Now, let's start to think about your digital workflow. And one of the things you can sit down and do when you have a moment is to look through the various points at which information flows to you in terms of conventional paper, for instance. So we're going to talk now a little bit about going paperless or less paper. So how does information come to you? The sort of records that you're meant to keep. It's not just the things that you create, your notes, for instance, but there are things that come to you, referral notes, better access plans that may be given to you or faxed to you. What are you going to do with them? There could be homework assignments that you give still in paper that are then brought back to you by your patients. And there's a variety of that you may share with patients or with colleagues for that matter, which may be movies or audio recordings, multimedia elements which you now start to incorporate into your practice. Certainly I encourage you to do that. So now I want to look at something what we might call the digital workflow. And so at every opportunity, when you cast your little mind map or your workflow, at what point of entry could I digitize something? Could I change it from analog, i.e. paper, into some sort of digital format? Number one, input. How do I get this analog stuff, paper, cassette recordings that I might have sitting around of my supervision sessions, whatever it might be, how do I get that into a digital format and then store it? So the second part is archiving. Now, archiving is not just storing things away. That would be a false meaning to give to archiving. Archiving is what we might also call active storage. It's not putting things into boxes like this and then going on a hunt if you have to try and retrieve something. So what I think is active storage, part of a paperless office, is how am I going to take that input, having digitized my paperwork, for instance, and how am I going to store it, which also, of course, incorporates where am I going to store it. And then the third part, which becomes part of that active storage, if I'm going to store it, how do I retrieve it? Can I retrieve it on an as-needed basis, on a momentary basis? I need that now. Do I have to sit up the night before and retrieve it somehow? If I'm not in the office, if I'm away somewhere and I get a phone call that says, we really need that report now, and you're on holiday somewhere in New York, and some, for whatever reason, the court case that you've been a part of says, we've moved it forward, we need it now, and you're away, I'm sorry, you can't have it until I get back. Or do you find a way to access those files and come good on your report presentation? So these are some of the things we've got to consider with these three things: input, archiving, and retrieving. Okay, without considering those three elements at least, then we really can't consider ourselves to have gone paperless. Now, the easiest and simplest and perhaps most economical, but not necessarily the most effective piece of technology I want to appraise you of is this. This is a multifunction unit, what's called an MFP, actually, a multifunction printer. This is the one in my office, and it comes from Epson. It wasn't very expensive. These things are coming down in price incredibly, but it's the consumables, the inks and so forth, where companies make their money. The units themselves, one almost doesn't bother to repair them if they go wrong. One throws them out, unfortunately, and buys a new one. But this is an Epson workforce unit. I actually purchased this one as a refurbished unit from Epson at
half price,
but with full warranty. And what does this machine do? Well, it's a large hunking kind of machine, not my preferred smallish machine, but if you're a single person operator and you need one machine to take up the least amount of space, this is probably the one to go for. It's an extremely fast inkjet printer, so it will do both sides simultaneously. That's very handy. Second, it will also document scan. Up the top here is a document scanner, and you can load it up with 30 or 40 pages, and it will scan both sides. Doesn't do it simultaneously. It scans it in one way, then it brings it out, and then puts it in again. Basically, that's also how it prints. It prints one side, then it puts it back in and prints the other side. You can lift up the lid and use it as a basic photocopier, so you can photocopy by using the scanning and printing device at the same time. And of course, you can also scan, and it goes directly into your computer. Now, all the equipment I'm going to show you is Mac and Windows, that is. So nothing I'm going to show you, unless I specifically say so, only works with one of these platforms. So, I actually bought it, one, because I wanted to replace my LaserJet printer. It was getting a bit old in the tooth. I'd had it for quite a few years printing in color. Nice, but expensive. And it's a really fast printer. So only after hitting print, within the next 5 to 10 seconds, the printing operation starts and I've got my print. And it's really useful if I'm doing a print of a sort, often an invoice, and all I want to do is print one. With a laser writer, it's got a warm up and start up, and it's a particularly inefficient use of power. Inkjets, great. And this particular one, in fact, is Wi-Fi, which means you don't need to physically connect it to your PC or Mac, and it also means that you can have multiple people coming in and using that printer if you give them permission, as long as you can let them join your Wi-Fi network and give them your
password,
and then they can print, believe it or not, from their tablets, from their smartphones, because this particular unit comes with an app which is free to download, and you can both scan and print remotely. This particular machine also sends and receives faxes if you wish to do so, but it does require a landline to do it. I actually don't send faxes or receive faxes over landline. I use email, and perhaps a little bit later on, I'll show you how I do that via email. That seems to be, for many, their preferred way of receiving information, and they electronically can fax it. This is not the same as using email, but it's a fax service. The advantage is that I only have one fax number, no matter what location I happen to be. I can always receive a fax if someone wants to fax me, because I have a one permanent fax number. So we'll talk a bit more about that later on in today's session. I'm sure some of you will be interested, because fax technology isn't quite dead yet. Now, so this is the Epson. There is one trouble with it. One, it's bulky. Two, it's slow. It prints fast, but it scans slow. So I want to introduce you to a workhorse device which I think every practice should have. Something of its ilk, if not this exact machine. This exact machine is the Fujitsu ScanSnap IX500. Lots of words. It's one of a series of prosumer scanners. Prosumer means it's a combination of professional use as well as consumer use. Now, Fujitsu makes a very large range of consumables like this, some just aimed at the consumer and some very expensive multi-thousand dollar units aimed in the corporate setting, as are their printers too. I want to remind you, I'm not making these recommendations because I get paid to do them. It's because I use them, having done what I think is due diligence. So let me now introduce you to the Fujitsu ScanSnap iX500. And I think the easiest way to do that is just to let you see some of their professionally made videos.
Introducing the ScanSnap iX500, the most powerful desktop ScanSnap yet. With advanced GI processor technology, the ScanSnap iX500 brings a whole new level of ease of use and productivity to home, small office, and now, the world of mobile devices. Ease of use is at the very heart of ScanSnap. Just lift the lid, place your stack of paper in the document feeder, and press the scan button. That's it. ScanSnap iX500 quickly scans both sides of each page into crystal clear PDF or JPEG images at a blazing 25 pages per minute. And with the most advanced ScanSnap feeder system yet, even those tough documents are easy to scan. Got a tablet or smartphone? Expand your scanning options with the PC-less scanning function. By installing the free ScanSnap Connect app, you can now scan a PDF or JPEG file wirelessly to your mobile device without even powering up your computer for a whole new level of time savings and convenience. Alongside exceptional hardware performance, ScanSnap performs intelligently as well. As each sheet passes through, ScanSnap can make PDF files searchable, automatically determine if they're color, set the proper crop size and orientation of each page, and even remove blank sides. And a new bleed-through detection feature cleans away unwanted noise from your scans, all working in the background to produce great results fast. ScanSnap iX500 is a powerhouse of features, and the new customizable quick menu provides you with several scan-to options to be more organized and productive. Scan to a folder, to a printer or a new email as an attachment. Scan printed pages back into a Word, Excel, or PowerPoint file for text editing. Scan a business card and automatically extract the contact information into changeable fields. Even scan directly to your existing Evernote, Dropbox, Google, or SugarSync account. Need to scan to another application or web service not already in the Quick Menu? If it can open, attach, or insert a PDF or JPEG file from Windows, chances are the highly versatile ScanSnap folder function can scan directly into it. The incredible ScanSnap iX500 with GI processor gives you the intelligence, speed, reliability, and high-quality imaging you need to convert paperwork into data that can be easily read, searched, shared, and stored. It's the ultimate productivity tool.
Now, the beauty of this scanner is that it's a one-trick pony. It's expensive. It's over $500. It's not particularly portable, although you can carry around with you. Fujitsu does make a series of portable scanners, also wireless, which you may be interested in. But this one is meant to sit on your desktop. It's Wi-Fi, which means you can either direct it to connect to your computer via USB cable. It uses USB 3, which is the fastest form of USB at the moment. Or you can use it over Wi-Fi and it will scan directly into your Mac or PC or into your tablet, which is terrific. Fujitsu has included various apps so you can scan directly into your tablet. The beauty of it is that as soon as you switch the cover open so that you can insert your paper, it switches it on. There's no on-off switch that you've got to find around the back. Just open it up and it starts to work. A little blue light will go on, and on your computer screen, the app that it uses will go on as well. It will change color. You then load it up. Now, here's what the interesting part is. It will take around 50 sheets or so. and it will do double sides simultaneously. Also, should it be the case that you have the sheet upside down in the middle, so you've put in four sheets the wrong way up, rather than having to go back into the resultant scan to be able to write it up, it actually has built-in character recognition that will automatically rotate it in the resulting PDF file. And so it's automatically rotated, so you don't have to go back in later on. I like equipment like this which saves time because it saves clicks, mouse clicks, handling, which is what I like. So once it's in there, what happens next? So it just scans through quite quickly, as you can see. So as it turns out, when patients come to me and they've got a better access referral of four or five pages, including a doctor's referral, I'll sit there with them, go through the document with them, scan it in. Sometimes I'll show it to them on the screen, on a big screen that I have on my projector, the resultant scan, put together, because as you may have discovered too, not always is the doctor's referral correct. There are some factual mistakes here. It's an old address, old telephone number. Sometimes patients even say, I have no idea I was even on that medication. Sometimes there's confusion about that. So I like to make sure that at the very beginning that I demonstrate transparency. Occasionally patients have said to me that they've never even read the referral. They've signed off on a document, but they haven't even read it. And certainly not read the doctor's. And I prefer to have my patients know what's in that letter. And that's because when I write back, I want them to know also what I'm going to write back. And sometimes I will actually sit with patients and we'll write the letter together. That's something for you to think about for yourselves. So this is the scanner, and it may be the case that when you get the scanner, from then on, you start to scan everything. Some of my colleagues to whom I've introduced this particular scanner have gone back through their years of folders and have spent the summer paying someone, it comes into the thousands of dollars, just to scan and digitize this using this particular scanner. But you make a decision and you get going with it, and then everything that's related to your practice, bills, accounts, wherever it might be, things that you haven't created on your computer, but things that need to be on your computer or in storage, get scanned. Okay. Question then is, where does it get scanned to? So this is where we need to focus on the second part of the whole input, archiving, and retrieving part. Where is it going to be archived? So if we stay with our scanner for a while, once the material goes through that scanner, it could be paper, as in letters, documents of some sort, whatever material it is, the question becomes, where does it go? Well, of course, the scanning manufacturers are not silly. They have provided us with a disk full of opportunities to store this material. This is software. So when you have installed your scanner, usually something like this becomes available. You have a matrix here of selections of what should happen to the scanned material. Remember, these are pictures, either as JPEGs or as PDFs. Now the question becomes, what should the scanner software do with it? That scanner software is installed on your Mac or your PC, or in fact on your iPad or your phone, because the scanner that I'm using is Wi-Fi and can actually scan directly to your mobile device. So where should it go? Well, it could go straight to email. So let's just say I have a series of documents I want to email to someone. I can tell the ScanSnap, send this immediately to email. And if my email reader is closed, it will automatically open it up and embed that resultant file, let's say a PDF, into a new email. And then it's up to me to select who it's to go to. I can also tell it to copy. So I can then say, send it to this printer. And automatically, it will open up that printer document and we're ready to send it to the printer. So the printer acts now like a photocopier. That's great. We can also tell it to go to a folder. That folder might be patient files. And then later on, we'll take the resultant file and put it into a folder named perhaps after our patient. That's kind of double handling, so maybe that's not the best way, but it's a way of doing things. Let me show you what I do when I get a referral. It includes a GP letter, mental health treatment plan, as a for instance. For you, it could be also you get a solicitor's letter requesting documentation, whatever it might be. So anything to do with your patients or your professional work, you can scan in and then select where should it go. For me, it opens up automatically. Once I've finished the scan and there's no more pages to go in, it will go to and open up an app called Evernote. And I now want to spend a few moments talking about the value of having an app like Evernote stored on your computer. Here's the symbol for Evernote. It's an icon with an elephant. And what do we associate elephants with? Well, memory, of course, prodigious memory. In a sense, your Evernote app is like an outrigger brain. And if we think about those four elements of great technologies I mentioned before, enabling, extending, augmenting, and connecting or sharing, Evernote fulfills all four of those qualities of a great technology. It enables because it acts as an extra memory pathway. The things that we can't remember ourselves and store in our heads, it will store on our computers. Moreover, it can also store it in the cloud. And we'll get to that a little later. That is, it stores off-site so that you can access it from a variety of machines. Evernote's been around for quite some time, and it uses Macs and PCs, Android and iPads and iPhones, and even Blackberries. So you can access it from a variety of machines. When you join Evernote and you get the premium service at $5 a month, they will also give you an email address so that you have a separate email address with Evernote stored in there so that you can access materials via email. That can come in quite handy. So how Evernote works is that when our scan is finished, and I've told it open up Evernote if Evernote's not already opened up, it will scan it in and call it untitled, but it actually has a name, and the name is year, month, day, hour, minute, and second the scan started. That's its automatic name, and that's the permanent name that we'll always have. But then you can rename it. So it could be Jack Smith's medical referral. And then it allows you to tag it. Now, tagging is really interesting because it allows you to add descriptive terms, keywords, that you can search later on. So if you want to find all my medical referrals, you simply type in medical referral and everything that's been tagged medical referral will pop in. You can rename it by the doctor who made the referral, by the location, whether it's a 2710, a 2712, what sort of referral it is. You can name it and tag it, and all the tags are there to help you search later on. Bear in mind too that Evernote will allow you to search within the document too. So even though it's actually a picture file, you can actually search within the document and make rapid searches as well. Now, Evernote opens up notebooks. Think of a notebook as a folder, so that when you create a folder on your computer, you can create files which will go into a folder. So you might have a nest of folders: professional work, patients, and then the individual patients within that folder. And the same thing can happen with notebooks. Later on, you can amalgamate the notebooks, you can merge them. So let's just imagine that just the 1 week you've completed your work with three different patients. You can merge those three separate notebooks into one and say, call it archived patients. Should one of those patients return the following year for another better access program of 10, you can extract those merged documents and set up a new one. Or alternatively, you can open up, say, Peter Smith 2, if that's the name of your patient, and call that notebook Peter Smith 2 or Peter Smith 2014 or 15, and then merge it later on when those 10 sessions are up. Whatever the case is, all your notebooks are eminently searchable. If you have multiple practices, you can set up an individual notebook for each of those practices where you keep your bills, the rent you've paid, the utilities, the costs, your outgoings, your incomes, wherever it might be, can all go into an individual notebook per location. Many of you, I'm sure, perhaps do work from multiple locations and from multiple sources of income. So you could name it a traffic accident commission, you could name it work cover, a third party EAP that you work for, and create a notebook from there. And they all talk to each other, so that's great. The other thing that you can do is not just bring in scans, but you can actually type in, if you wish, your case notes per session and have your case notes there. You can dictate your case notes in there. So Evernote has the opportunity to create very small audio files which remain inside, embedded in the Evernote file. But here's the really interesting thing, that Evernote will also send your files, if you choose to, into its own cloud or a cloud of your choice, that is an offsite recording area. Think of it as a disk offsite where you can store it. Later on, should you choose, you can retrieve it, so that if for some reason you have to take in your laptop for repair and it's not available to you, and you borrow a laptop or some other device in the meantime, you can just bring them down into the Evernote and use them as if it's the original article. And that's the beauty of this sort of thing. You have an automatic backup. So think about the sequence here. We put our documents into the ScanSnap, and with one button, it scans it, brings it into Evernote, and then within a few moments, without us having to do anything, as long as we've set this as the default, it will send it up to the Evernote cloud. That Evernote cloud is protected by password and by your username. Okay? Now, it doesn't encrypt it in the cloud, unless you choose to. If it encrypts it in the cloud, it will mean that it might make it harder to search, because it runs a series of ones and zeros over and makes it very hard to search within it. You can't search within it. But if that doesn't mean anything to you, just want to retract the file, bring it back to you, then that's fine. If you choose to, if you make case notes, you can actually encrypt the case notes with a mouse click, and those notes will go up encrypted. Again, you can't search within it once it's encrypted this way, and that might suit you fine. To then access those notes for next time, you then have to put in your password to de-encrypt it. And we're going to see more and more of this as time goes on, this notion of encryption and de-encryption. Evernote, as I said, will also allow you to make audio recordings. So if you choose to, you can audio record the session. It will allow you to take picture files, and that's kind of handy as well. So you can take a picture of a patient if you want to include that. You can take a picture of a business card, whatever it might be, and you can add it as an attachment to your Evernote file. The beauty of Evernote is that it will allow you to access your files off-site and from a variety of hardware, iPads, iPhones, Blackberries, Android tablets, and so forth and so on. You can even be overseas at an internet cafe and access it there. Be mindful of privacy and so forth, but if you're suddenly asked very quickly to read a file of some sort, you can do it that way. The other thing is, you can also create public notebooks. And a public notebook means that you may have written material you wish to share with patients, and you don't mind if they have access to it. You can give it a password so only certain people can access it, but anyone can access that file, and it means you simply have to send a link to your patients by email and then have them download rather than you printing it out. That's very handy. It also means if the patient should lose it or get coffee stains over it, they can download it again on an as-needed basis. Just be sure that whatever you put up there in that cloud, you're not going to get yourself into some trouble by putting up copyrighted materials such as, say, the Beck Depression Inventory. You're supposed to pay for each one of those each time you administer it. That's an interesting question, so make sure that's what you do. There are other instruments, of course, which are open source, like the DAS and a variety of other ones. The Kessler, that's often used by doctors that we know about, these are all open source and they're not protected by copyright. But the Beck, definitely protected by copyright. So that's Evernote. Why don't I show you one of the Evernote professionally made videos so you get a really good idea.
Hi, welcome to Evernote. Evernote is a way to capture all your experiences and access them from anywhere. Type a note, store documents, record audio, capture a photograph, or any other moment you want to remember. Evernote saves and synchronizes your digital life across all your devices. No matter where you are, Evernote is with you. Use it to stay more organized. Plan your next trip. Design and manage a project. Clear your paper clutter. capture a moment, and always find what you need. Life is full of experiences, and Evernote helps you capture, manage, and remember them all.
Now, Evernote is not the only show in town. There are competitors to Evernote, and you'd hope so too, because it's important that we just don't become reliant on a monopoly. People will ask, what happens should Evernote go belly up? And one can ask that about any piece of software and hardware that we use on a regular basis. But if you're not an Evernote user and you are a Microsoft Office user, if you go into Office, you will find there's an app which has certain similar properties to Evernote, and it's called OneNote. OneNote is available as a Mac and PC software, and it is available also on a variety of mobile devices like iPads and other forms of tablets and smartphones. And it has Office to Evernote. And if you're a Microsoft user and you like the way Office integrates and operates, then OneNote might be the place for you to go to. I don't use it myself. I've had a little bit of a play, but for me, I'm an Evernote person. Your mileage will vary, as the saying goes. So that's material that comes to you. But what about material that you create yourself? Let's start by having a look at the written word. Now, most times, I type notes. If I'm working forensically, that is, I've been asked to produce a report about someone, I will try and type the notes in directly. I'll have the laptop sitting on my lap, small, little MacBook Air as it's called, a little notebook sitting on my lap, and I'm not that particularly concerned with maintaining eye contact. I want sufficient rapport that I hopefully will get a direct and frank account of what's happened, whether the person I'm interviewing might be a perpetrator or a victim or a friend of either of those who has given me more information, and depends on how you work. So with those people, so as I don't have to do too much double handling, I'll actually type in as we go along, not quite verbatim notes, but in some cases, typing in exact quotes of what you've been told is really, really useful when it comes to court. In many victims' cases, not so much perpetrators, but in victims' cases, survivors if you prefer, I will ask their permission to audio record the session, say using something like Evernote and the built-in microphone on the Mac, just so I can get accurate quotes. My finding is, forensically, that when I can quote directly how a person expresses themselves, what they've been through, rather than saying she reported, he reported, I'd rather say, this is the quote that was told to me. She said, boom, not rather than she gave a report of. Your mileage will vary, depends on the sort of scheme you've set up to work with. But because therapeutic rapport is not of the essence when I'm doing forensic reports, I don't mind having a laptop on my lap, typing away, and not having as much eye contact as I would when I work therapeutically. Now, when that's the case, unlike our colleague Tony McHugh, who said he writes contemporaneous notes as he goes along, I've got to tell you, I've never really found that to be the way I want to work. It seems to me that I sometimes cue in the people of what to talk about because I'm writing down something. What happens when I'm not writing something? Does that mean that it's not that important in my mind? So I kind of get the feeling that I'm cueing them up or shaping up what I expect from them. Frankly, it's not the way I like to work, each to their own. I prefer to have as much eye contact as possible. Where I need to write things down directly, I will usually actually make a bit of a song and dance about it and say, you know what, that's such an important thing, I need to write this down. And I'll make a big deal about writing it down. Either I'll type it in or I'll write it in. I'm going to show you in a moment how I write it in nowadays. But I'll usually make a bit of a song and dance about it because I want them to know that I think this is important. Other times, it's more an acknowledgement that I have a poor memory, perhaps. And so if it's a date, a name, a location, wherever it might be, and I think it may end up being important to note, then I'll actually say, look, hold on, let me just write this down. But for me, the rest of the time, I prefer to take summary notes of what's happened and what the plan is towards the end of the session and then in between sessions when I have some time. I let you know what I do. I actually, at the end of the session, leave the last 5 minutes to say, let's summarize what we did today and let's plan what's going to happen in next week's session. That's just the way I work. I work in a very structured cognitive behavioral kind of way. People come to me with a very definite end point in mind. I want to be able to do this when our work is concluded. Not so much I want to be able to feel this. That is, I'm not working so much on affect and changes of mood, so I tend to work less with depression. I work much more with anxiety, but it's usually anxiety about certain situations or scenarios. So we both have, as the work unfolds, we both have a very clear idea of what it's going to look like when our work has concluded successfully. So in that sense, I tend to make a bit of a song and dance towards the end about what we accomplished today, make notes of that, and then incorporate a plan as to what's going to go on. And that's what we're going to review the next time we meet and go through the plan, unless something has come up between last session and the next session that maybe changes the content of the next session that's coming up. So some of you who take notes both during the session and after the session may not like to type, nor may you like to dictate. And we're going to come to dictation in a moment because it tends to be underrated. And I think it need not be any longer. So let me show you the software and hardware that I'm using. I just have to lean across here. Now, this is the LiveScribe system I want to show you. So what we have here is the usual book. I'll hold it up with my rather scribbly handwriting in there and some other people's handwriting and some notes that I took at a recent conference. Okay. And attached to it is a pen, which I can slide out here. So we have a pen. But it's not your usual pen. It's a special pen and with special paper. Okay. Now what you can't see is that apart from the blue lines on the paper, there are tiny, tiny, tiny little dots throughout this paper. And each page has a number. And each page has a unique arrangement of dots on the page. The pen is interesting because if you look closely, there is no pen sticking out from it. But should I turn the middle part here, watch here and watch as the pen nib comes out, like so, and hopefully you'll see that the pen light has come on. At the moment, I hold it up there, it's in green. Now, that means that the pen has power, and if I pop the top from it, you can actually see, if I get up a bit close, you can see how it can actually plug in there. Okay, this pops on. That's how you power up the pen. This part here is actually a nib, so you can actually hold it up to an iPad or a tablet and write on it. Okay, that's kind of handy. So the pen is switched on now. When you retract the nib, it's just regular ink, by the way. If you retract the nib, it just goes in. This is called the LiveScribe 3. And it's one of a variation of pens from the LiveScribe company who are trying to take regular handwriting and turn it into recordable digital format. It's been around on the market for a little while. So let me show you the very first iteration of the LiveScribe pen. They were called Pulses, LiveScribe Pulse, quite different to this. So here's the little advertisement that LiveScribe.
Now I want to step by the final step of Manly. The axial acetate wrings out the last bit of energy as NADH is the original glucose. The axial acetate can finally bond with another acetylcholine, and the whole process starts all over again. And that's the Krebs cycle. You got that?
You got that. Introducing the Pulse Smart Pen from LiveScribe. It records everything you hear and links it to what you write.
Records everything and links it to what you write.
So you never miss a word.
Next step, get the Skyway up to code. Get the numbers on the 10-acre cornfield. Let's go with idea 7. Hold that to next quarter. Typo paragraph 3. Yes, but I want a 4-to-1 return. That's not a caribou, Anderson. It's an elk. I want these changes tomorrow. You got that?
You got that. Introducing the Pulse Smart Pen from LiveScribe. It records everything you hear and links it to what you write. So you never miss a word. So what makes the Pulse Smart Pen smart? For one thing, it's what's inside. It has an infrared camera at the tip which tracks everything you write or draw, and a built-in microphone that records crisp, clear sound. Inside is a computer that remembers everything you write, draw, and hear. You can play back what was recorded through the Pulse's built-in speaker or headphones. First, tap the record button on your notebook, and the Pulse Smart Pen begins recording everything you write and hear. Write or draw what you need. Then tap the stop button to finish recording. Later, you can replay the audio linked to your notes by tapping on them, so you never miss a word. First, tap the record button. Never miss a word. Pretty smart, huh? The Pulse Smart Pen makes it easy to transfer your notes and audio to a computer. Using the USB charging cradle, you can connect to your PC or Mac, where your notes and audio are transferred automatically. With LiveScribe Desktop, you can store and organize your notes, search for words, and replay that moment in time.
Distance equals rate times time. This is very important for the test.
So leave your laptop at home. This is all you need. The Pulse Smart Pen makes it easy to share your pencasts privately or publicly. First, upload your notes from your laptop to your My LiveScribe page. Email a private link. Or post them publicly on the LiveScribe community or Facebook. With the Pulse Smart Pen, it's easy to share what you want with who you want. Pretty smart, huh?
So, what we have underneath the pen here is a laser. And as it writes across the paper, it reads that unique collection of tiny, tiny dots, each page with its own unique selection, and the pen stores it in memory inside the pen. The earlier pens, not that this one, the LiveScribe 3, the earlier pens had 8 gigabytes of storage. And it didn't just store the pages on which you wrote, but also stored audio. So built into the pens were microphones and loudspeaker outlets. You could actually hook up headphones. And as you were writing in a lecture or in a session, you would also record what was being said in the session. Now, of course, you obtain permission from your patient to record the session and you explain to them where that audio recording will be stored and how it will be protected. I think you've got to do that. I do that. But I think it's imperative that you do that and that you ensure that the storage, if it's on your computer or in the cloud, is as safe as can be. What you then do with the pen, once you finish your day's work or after a session, the older pen, you would hook it up, as you saw in the little video, and it would then bring it onto your PC or your Mac. So I like to show things in our work here which are compatible with both systems, PC and Mac. Okay. Now, what's also interesting is that LiveScribe in recent years has now integrated with Evernote. So like the ScanSnap, you can treat your pen as if it was a scanner, which it kind of is. If you think about it, it's scanning the writing, the blue ink on your paper, and it will send it up to Evernote. You can make sure that they're compatible and it will send your notes to Evernote and then send it to the cloud. So you're in one little movement, your writing is backed up onto your computer and into the cloud. Now, when I've given workshops around Australia on IT, I ask people, what do you do with your handwritten notes? Well, they go into a file, into a manila folder, and into a filing cabinet. Oh, good. And at the end of the week, do you photocopy all those notes? Oh, no. Well, what should happen if this happens? This is the Brisbane River flood of a few years ago. Imagine if this was your practice and your filing cabinet is floating down the river. And even if you should recover your filing cabinet, well, it's possible that somebody else will, but you're going to now have to hope that they actually can't recover the files because you don't want your privacy to be interfered with, that of your patients, that is. But moreover, by the time it's recovered, having been flooded for a couple of days, I don't think the ink will be still on that paper. And you might find 30 years of practice not so much goes up in smoke, but just becomes a mushy pulp of paper. Or have a look at this disastrous situation. This is a picture from Christchurch. This was a five-story building, and I think the third level, what was the third level, was a counselling service of some duration in Christchurch. And unfortunately, a number of people were killed in that service at the collapse in Christchurch a few years ago. And, well, it's not just that legally you are in a spot of trouble, even though you can explain it away, but also just if you're in private practice or in commercial practice, think of business continuity. How do you contact your patients or your contacts, whatever it might be, when everything's been destroyed? So it means that somewhere or other, if you're doing handwritten notes on paper, really, whatever else happens, get yourself a scanner and start to scan in those notes either at the end of the session or at the end of the week, wherever it happens to be. If you wish, you can cut that middle step out by having one of these devices so that your handwritten notes will go into the cloud, onto your computer, and onto your other devices as soon as you tell it to stop recording. Let me share a story with you that a colleague of mine, Jack White, who's a well-known forensic psychologist in South Australia, recorded some sessions with a defendant whom he felt was not as central to a rather nasty murder case. And it was important that the judge and jury actually heard how he expressed himself describing what happened in the actual recording, and he used a LiveScribe pen. Now, this is the LiveScribe 3, and it's a little different. And what's been happening in recent years is that our smartphones, let me take out my smartphone here. So this is the new Apple 6. It's quite sizable. I got this the day after it was released in Melbourne. This is the iPhone 6, not the Plus, which is the really big one. This is the iPhone 6, 128 gig. And these processors in here are almost equivalent to the sort of processors that you could get in a laptop several years ago. They're very powerful. So LiveScribe, in its wisdom, said, well, we can make the pen more pen-like, lighter in weight, easier to manipulate and use as a pen compared to the heavier ones with its memory, and also make it almost unlimited memory, or that is the memory of our smartphone devices, by having the LiveScribe pen hand over its recordings to our mobile devices. So it developed an app for your iPhone and iPad, only those two at the moment, not yet gone to Android, so that when you write, the writing actually appears on your iPad or your iPhone once you open up the app. And also, should you choose to audio record the session, the iPhone and the iPad also audio record the session. They have much better quality microphones built into them compared to this. And all you have to do on the page is tap record, which is written on the page, and it starts the recording. And this little light up here will go to red, which tells you that it's recording. On the iPad or iPhone app, a little red bar will appear, and that tells you it's recording. And you've got all those 64 or 128 gigabytes of recording, hours and hours of recording. And of course, it can send it up to the cloud and it can be stored up there as well. If you don't have your iPad with you, that is, you're not going to make an audio recording, you just want to make the paper recording, this thing itself will store about 20,000 pages in the memory that's built into it alone. You can get small paper books, you can get post-it notes even. And I did once supervise a psychologist who was complained against, and as it turned out, she had kept all the post-it notes of the broken and unattended and other phone calls that came in as part of her paper trail, and it stood her in good stead when she had to confront the various tribunal or the panel about a complaint. issues out and have a paper trail. So this is a great use of modern technology, and because most of us are walking around with these smartphones, you can actually write down and write from the book directly into the into your phone and into the iPad at the same time if you want to. But it does a little bit more than that, so let me show you the current video about the Live Scribe 3, and I think you'll really be quite amazed what it can do.
The Live Scribe 3 Smart Pen turns your words into action. Your handwritten notes instantly appear on your tablet or smartphone. Once on your device, it's easy to convert your handwriting into text and send it to your friends or colleagues. Your tablet or smartphone can record audio as you write to capture the things you don't.
Hi, this is Mr. Green. I'm calling to confirm my reservation on April 18th.
Certainly, I have you down for two people at 7:30 p.m.
And your address is 252 California Street in San Francisco, correct?
Yes, that is correct.
Excellent. We're looking forward to it. Goodbye.
Goodbye.
Your notes become more useful when they appear in your favorite apps. Simply tap your notes to play back audio from that moment in time.
252 California Street in San Francisco, correct?
With the Live Scribe 3 Smart Pen, turn your words into action.
So I hope you found the Live Scribe interesting. In my previous workshops, live workshops, it's often been the killer app. People are really excited by this and saying, you can really do this. But for many people, it's kind of a halfway house. It's not quite writing on an iPad, and it's not quite just writing in on paper. And what many people would like to know is, can you actually write directly onto the iPad? As it turns out, one of the first categories of app that became popular on the iPad were writing applications, where you could actually write directly onto the screen. But the early iPads were somewhat limited. The power was low, the screen capacitance wasn't great, the pens were these huge bulbous rubber tip things, and there was this lag between writing and what appeared. A bit like delayed auditory feedback, which gives you the stuttering. But the iPad itself has improved immensely in power with new units, and we expect come October, end of October, there'll be another group of new iPads with even better, faster engines and better screens and so forth. But also the pens themselves have improved from these huge rubber tip things into something like this. Now this is an Adonit, A-D-O-N-I-T, Jot script pen. And it comes actually with a Bluetooth connection, and you actually put a battery in here. If I hold it up close, you can actually see there's a little Evernote symbol. I don't know if you can actually see that. There you go. The little elephant. And it means that what you can do is write directly into an app which Evernote purchased. Now it's free. It used to cost 99 cents. It's called Penultimate. And this is an app which you can write directly in using Bluetooth. And you write in there and you have a much faster connection. And it also means that if you rest your palm there, it will eliminate your palm from making marks on it. The value, of course, is that the iPad's with you at all times, so you can make notes. You can change colors and thicknesses and whatever else it might be. Also, of course, you never run out of ink unless you run out of battery. And these last ages. And of course you never run out of paper, it just keeps on going and going and going and going as long as your iPad has battery power. So why it's called an Evernote Jot script is that not just can you write to in using the Penultimate app, but it also will send it up to Evernote, so your handwritten notes on your iPad will be sent to Evernote for your particular patient. So that's really handy. This is a microphone with one speaker, and it came with some software for voice dictation. So I now want to move around away from actually writing notes down to actually recording notes using voice. So this is voice transcription. So not just can you record the voice and make a little 3-minute summary, if you like, and then maybe give it to a receptionist, maybe even send it overseas as an MP3 and have it come back to you in text format, having prevented some personal information from being shared. So Patrick Smith becomes Mr. PS. And then when you bring that MP3 as text into your Word document, you can do a Word substitute. So every time PS appears, it will re-substitute Patrick Smith, which is fine. So you can do that as well. But many of us don't want to do that. We just want to do our own voice dictation. And that's what this particular device does. So this came with, it's not an inexpensive headset. And for those of you who've kind of said, had a bit of a go with voice dictation some time back and said, nah, not for me, I think you'll find that in the last probably 2 years, it's really, really improved. So that 95% out of the box accuracy, and then with some training, it gets really, really good. Now, if you have a Mac, and I'm speaking to the Mac people here, you'll know that in the current software, if you hit the function key, if you look down at your keyboard, hit the function key twice, it will actually open up something that looks like Siri. A little microphone will pop up and down. I'll show you now what it looks like. And you can use this to dictate. Now, in the first instance, this will go up to the cloud, and the cloud will do the translation for you. So it doesn't need any training at all. But if you don't have a net connection, you can download about 350 megabytes worth of data. And so you've actually got it stored on your computer. You don't really do long letters or long forms, but with something like Drag and Dictate from a company called Nuance, is one of the leading voice dictation people around, you can use this. So this is one of the microphones you can choose. It comes with USB and a rather long lead, so that you're not tethered to your desk and you can move around. What the Nuance people discovered is that people, especially in the creative arts, who want to dictate stories, their authors, fiction novelists, for instance, felt they didn't want to sit at a computer and type away here. So they like to walk around the room. So they gave them this sort of extra long cable. And of course, there's nothing to stop you from putting an extra longer extension in as well. If you don't have USB for whatever reason, you can take off this little digitizing element here, and you've got the two inputs, microphone and headset. And of course, it doubles up as a Skype unit, which is kind of handy. Now, in the early days of microphones, those Bluetooth ones that you often see taxi drivers wear weren't particularly good. But in recent years, they've improved. And this is the new Plantronics unit, same company as the other one. And you can see here, it's actually quite small. Let me show you how it goes on your ear. It just sort of rests across here and just sits in there. And you have a tiny little microphone. Can you see that? So yes, you do look a little bit dorky walking down the street with it. But what's really interesting, it uses Bluetooth, and most new computers come built with Bluetooth. Otherwise, you buy a little Bluetooth receiver, and you can use it for both Skype and for voice dictation. You can use it on your phone to connect. You can play podcasts through it, and you can, of course, answer phone. This one has automatic answering, so it'll pop in your ear if someone calls, and it recognizes the address book and says, Joe Smith is calling you. If Joe Smith is in your address book, do you want to answer or not? You just go, answer. And it automatically recognizes and just goes, whoop. So it can be totally hands-free, which is kind of handy. So somewhere in the history of technology, some geeks got together and decided that we'll invent a term for off-site storage. Sharing of documents off-site. That is, not within the same precinct, but away. And for whatever reason, they came up with this concept of cloud computing. It's very easy to get it confused with the clouds around us. But essentially, it just simply means that we have servers comprised of hard drives in locations away from where we are, where we can store large amounts of data. Now, you might say, oh, I don't want to go near the cloud. I heard what happened to Jennifer Lawrence and all that sort of stuff. Well, there's more to that story than meets the eye. But if you're using email, you're using cloud. If you're using a bank to do online banking, you're using cloud. It's everywhere. It's ubiquitous. And we might as well get used to what this concept is and then work to get the most out of what the cloud does. Cloud services have names like this. Let's name some of them. The most, and they're often free to start with. So that one of the most famous ones is Dropbox. Google has Google Drive. Microsoft has the newly named OneDrive, or what used to be SkyDrive, but it was now OneDrive. Apple offers us iDrive. And these are all not so much backup solutions, but they're storage solutions. We have to physically move things in there. And if we have multiple accounts, that is multiple devices, if we move a file in or out of our Dropbox on one device, that will be reflected in a change in the composition of that Dropbox in all of our other drives. So it's a way of storing and backing up materials, but it's pretty much a manual operation. In a moment, I'll talk to you about the automatic operations for backup, and we need to talk about backup in a moment. So cloud is a way to upload materials to store and to share. They have various forms of protection. But let me say this from the outset. None of them are perfect. So if you are looking for a perfect system which is unbendable, unbreakable, I can absolutely have 100% faith it'll never be cracked open. You might as well stop now. We kind of have to live with a little bit of risk here, I'm afraid. And I think the task is to say, I took an opportunity to evaluate the risk and I chose the best possible system with the available knowledge I had at the time, and I was very aware of the ins and outs of storing things in the cloud. That's to be preferred to being utterly naive. Naive would be not being aware that perhaps a cloud storage system has been broken into and there's been no repair done and you're going to now use that system. That would not be a good look. So what you will find is that responsible cloud storage systems, should they detect a break-in or an attempted break-in, will harden up the protection. And this is what we saw happening with Apple and its cloud storage once news of breaking in to people's iPhones and cloud storage has occurred with those famous actors and actresses, mainly actresses. There are other services I want to make mention of. One that I use and one that I can advise you is also a very good system. These are systems which operate like hard drives, which are attached to your computer, which automatically back up each time you make a change to a file. Now, let me introduce you for a moment to the wired services. Both Windows and Mac have built into their system software backup strategies. You simply attach an external hard drive. Here are two that work. This is a Western Digital for PCs, and this is a Mac one. This is from Apple called Time Machine. It's actually, this one's called Time Capsule. Both of them are routers, so you can actually don't have to have them physically connected to your computer. They do need to be connected to your router, although they can also operate by Wi-Fi, but best to have them connected physically by Ethernet router for safety. And they also act as routers, which means for each of them, let's just say you've got a three-person or four-person practice, rather than each of those people having their own separate little hard drive, you can use one of these drives, and they come in 1, 2, 4 terabyte sizes, so they're very large in terms of storage capacity. Each person can use the same time capsule to store and back up their devices or their materials, and this is really useful. So, I hope you enjoyed this webinar. Really was a distillation of a full day's workshop into an hour and a bit. So I hope I drew out some of the highlights, some of the areas of interest. I hope there was enough here for you to think, well, this could be a wanna rather than just a have to, and imbue some excitement into you in terms of these technologies which are in existence now, and that will be around the corner and just getting better and better. But your task is get started. Play with just one or two of them, introduce them gently into your practice, maybe not necessarily on every new patient that comes in. Start scanning in and start digitizing materials, but each new patient, try out one patient a day if you like with some of the new materials and just use it and get used to it, and like driving a car. The overwhelming amount of information you've got to use to drive it properly will start to reduce and becomes automatic after a while. And then eventually, just like with pencil and paper, the technology kind of disappears and you just get on with your job. But allow yourself a little bit of time to go from fright and fear into coping and then mastery and then hopefully innovation. I hope you've enjoyed tonight's session, and I hope you fill in the evaluation forms, and that we can continue a series like this in the next year or so. Good night.